Hello and welcome to our final episode of this series of True Crime in Science, our show that discusses real-life cases but delves further into the forensic details behind them. I'm your host, Eleanor Higgs, and today we're going to look at the murder of Candra Alston and how DNA phenotyping was used to digitally recreate the characteristics of her killer and how it led to his capture. Candra Alston was born in 1985 in Columbia, South Carolina. She had two children, a son, Deshaun Alston, and a daughter, Malaysia Boykin. On a winter evening in 2011, Candra, now 25, was at home with her daughter Malaysia, who was just 3 years old. Tragically, both Candra and Malaysia were killed that night. Police investigating the crime called it one of the most gruesome sights they had ever seen. A laptop, Gucci purse, and trash can were stolen from the apartment, as well as gifts Malaysia had received for Christmas. The murders seemed to be personal, and whoever killed Alston may have been in conflict with her. There were no signs of forced entry, which led investigators to believe that the victims knew their killer, or killers. There were no witnesses, and the only evidence they could work with was a bloody partial palm print. Police interviewed over 200 people who had some relation in one way or another to Candra, and took DNA samples from over 150 people. But unfortunately, there was no hard evidence they could use to charge anyone. However, by 2013, DNA extracted from the blood of the handprint was compared to the DNA they had taken from interviewees. By then, they had narrowed down the suspect list to 4 people. In 2015, a new technique to find the killer was suggested for this case, one that uses DNA samples to build a computer-generated image of someone. The technique is known as DNA phenotyping, and this was the first case in which it was utilized. DNA carries the genetic instructions for our individual characteristics, and an organism's phenotype is the physical expression of their genes. In this case, the DNA phenotyping technology used is called Snapshot. From the bloody handprint at the scene, the team at Snapshot who performed the DNA phenotyping were able to reverse engineer the DNA from the print into an image of a potential suspect. The person of interest involved in the crime was possibly a dark-skinned male with brown hair and brown eyes. According to Snapshot, they can predict genetic ancestry, eye colour, hair colour, skin colour, freckling, and face shape in individuals from any ethnic background, even individuals with mixed ancestry, with 80% accuracy. They can also exclude physical traits by up to 95% accuracy, with a margin of error of less than 2%. Police released his digital sketch to the public and hoped it would lead to an arrest, and in 2017 they finally made one. Investigators flew across the country to California to arrest a man named Kenneth Canzeta Jr. Kenneth was an acquaintance of Alston and was an original suspect, though he denied any involvement. Kenneth was charged with both the murder of Candra and her daughter Malaysia. An Alston family spokesperson, Sharon Williams, said, "Thank you, God. Thank you to the law enforcement officers about being vigilant, for never giving up for this family, because we knew that God would come to vindicate for this family." The case was brutal and unfortunately took too long for the perpetrator to face justice. Yet the fact it was served at all after so many years is a testament to the advancements of DNA phenotyping, which we will now break down. DNA stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. They are macromolecules that store the mass majority of genetic information that is essential to life in multicellular organisms, such as plants and animals. In humans, DNA is coiled very tightly into 23 pairs of structures called chromosomes. Other organisms often have a different number of chromosomes. DNA is made up of units called nucleotides. There are 4 nucleotides that can be found in DNA: adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine. These chemical bases form sequences called genes. These genes contain the instructions for performing a function in a cell or making a certain protein. Some of these proteins can make up physical characteristics, known as our phenotypes. Our collective genes are known as the genome. DNA phenotyping, also known as molecular photofitting, predicts the physical characteristics of an organism based on their genetic code found in their DNA. A biological sample undergoes DNA sequencing, which determines the exact order of the nucleotides. With the right expertise and knowledge, a prediction of the organism's physical traits can be made. In forensic DNA phenotyping, DNA will be obtained at the crime scene. This could be from biological samples such as blood, hair, saliva, skin cells, or fingernails. There are many different methods to sequence DNA. but generally, the DNA in the biological samples related to a criminal investigation will be extracted, purified, undergo quality assurance, and then sequenced. The world of DNA sequencing is constantly evolving, and as such, there are many different workflows and techniques on how to sequence DNA, including Sanger sequencing or next-generation sequencing. Which workflow and techniques are used for DNA phenotyping depends on the forensic laboratory and the context of the crime. For example, the quality of the DNA, the complexity of the traits being analysed, and time and resource constraints. There are direct and indirect methods to predict phenotypes after this. Direct methods use statistical methods to figure out a trait of an organism, then match with the relevant phenotype's expression. In forensic DNA phenotyping, often the indirect method is used. This is when they look for variants associated with the genetic components of ancestry. Ancestry informative markers, known as AIMs, which are single nucleotide polymorphisms, or also known as SNPs, that vary in frequency across major human populations, can be used and then combined with the appropriate statistical methodologies. A SNP is a single change in DNA sequence. For example, one stretch of DNA, you may have a thymine replace a cytosine. These changes occur across the entirety of our genome, and we can see that there are patterns across people and populations with various different traits. In forensic DNA phenotyping, a scientist can look at specific SNPs that are attributed to different physical appearances. Complex algorithms can combine the data output from the DNA analysis to reverse engineer an image of the person who created the original biological sample. The uncertainty of DNA phenotyping has raised numerous concerns. DNA phenotyping is a probabilistic technique, which means that predictions that are made may not always be accurate, which can lead into false identification. Some claim people could be easily altered by cosmetic makeup or surgeries, or adopt false identities to avoid recognition from a forensic profile. The human genome is also influenced by the environment and epigenetics, which are random DNA mutations organisms are subject to throughout their life, which would make identifying subjects difficult. Phenotyping often involves the assay of AIMs, which are polymorphism sets of DNA sequences that can be used in estimating the continental origins of an individual's ancestors. Scholars fear it could lead to law enforcement services stereotyping suspects based on presumptions of their ethnicities and appearances. Along with this, the database that the sequences are referred to could have a database or algorithmic bias, so some populations, especially minorities, could be over or underrepresented. Phenotyping is a very new tool in forensic science and continuously advancing. While it may not be perfect just yet, it clearly helped bring justice for Candra Alston and her daughter Malaysia, but it has also been of use in other cases too. In 2016, two composites made by DNA phenotyping of men believed to be individually responsible for the deaths of 12-year-old Michaela Welch and 13-year-old Jennifer Bastian were released to the public. In 2018, Gary Charles Hartman and Robert D. Washburn were charged with the murders of the two girls. In 2019, Washington State passed a law called HB 1326, also known as Jennifer and Michaela's Law, which allow police to take DNA samples from alive and deceased people convicted of indecent exposure or felonies. On the 2nd of February 2016, police released the proposed first composite created by combining DNA phenotyping and forensic facial reconstruction from a victim's skull. The victim, found in 1985, suffered severe upper body trauma and the date of death was penned in to be 1963. A certified forensic artist performed the physical facial reconstruction from digital adaptation of a picture, made up from DNA phenotyping, to reflect details gleaned from the victim's facial morphology. In 2019, the body was identified as Roger Kelso, born in Fort Wayne, Indiana, in 1943. DNA phenotyping could be an incredibly useful tool for other cold cases and in crime scenes with a lack of witnesses. It can help to identify killers and victims alike, and if used properly, can help make profiles of entire populations, which can aid in information about ancestry. And with that concludes this series of True Crime and Science. We hope that you have enjoyed learning more about the forensic details behind cases as much as we have enjoyed teaching it. If you've enjoyed the series, please give the episode a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button.